It's good to have you, bro.
No, it's a pleasure.
Bro, I wanted to start off with South Africa. My mate told me he's going to South Africa.
Yeah, yeah.
And yeah, I told him you went. But I don't really think you told me much about your trip.
Oh, South Africa, man.
Yeah. I mean, you've been it's around,
my favorite accent in the world.
Yeah.
And the best barbecue I've ever had.
Yeah.
By far, South African braai.
Yeah.
All the South Africans out there, they know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Lovely, lovely people. If it wasn't for the crime, I would live there. I would actually pack up everything and move, and I would go live in South Africa. I love the culture. They're very much like Aussies. They're very jovial. They have a laugh. I find, you know, I've got a lot of British friends, like brothers that live in Britain and stuff like that, brothers in Canada, America. Americans are a bit loose. The Canadians, they're a little bit like the British. They're a bit dry. They're funny in their own way, but our humor is very different, Aussies.
Yeah.
You know, we'll make you laugh at a funeral. South Africans are like us.
Yeah.
They're very much like Aussies, man. They love their food. They love barbecues, getting together, the boys hanging out. They love all that. So when I went there, I felt like I was at home, to be honest, you know. The crime is very, you know, we went there, we spoke to the youth, and we went to, you know, different places to meet different people. And, yeah, to be honest, like, I don't know how much I can say, you know, on YouTube, but, you know, we had to have guns with us.
Yeah.
When we were walking around, you know, it's that's just how it is. So I was taken back when we rocked up to, like, just random neighborhoods. It wasn't, like, anywhere posh or anything. You know, they've got, like, 4 or 5 meter high fences, you know. And I was like, who lives here? You know, and they go, this is just how everyone lives.
Yeah.
You know, high fences, electric fences, back-to-base alarm monitoring, cameras, guard dogs. You know, they got glass at the top and barbed wire. And I was like, who the hell? Like, who would live like that?
Yeah. Would you consider it third world? Or would you say parts of it?
Yeah, to be honest, yeah. Most parts of it are third world. Like, there is people. Like, we went to some ghetto areas.
Yeah.
Bro, some of the richest people in the world live in South Africa.
You know? So mostly it isn't, you'd say?
Nah, there's a lot of slums, a lot of ghettos, a lot of people struggling there. You know, they went through a lot of hardship during the apartheid era.
Yeah.
That ended in the early 90s when the Dutch got overthrown, and then the black Africans have taken back their country and stuff like that. But the way it was given to them or taken back, it was very hard for them to control everything, and there was a lot of corruption and all that sort of stuff. So they got stuck with a mess. And they're still suffering, to be honest, at the moment. You know, there's a lot of crime, killing each other and stuff like that.
Yeah. Is it a big place? What would you compare
it to? So we went to Johannesburg. And then we traveled to Pretoria, which is the capital.
Yeah.
And then we kept going to Pietermaritzburg, and then we went to Durban. So we covered like one whole side of the country, but we didn't go to Cape Town. And they say, you haven't been to South Africa until you've been to Cape Town. They reckon it's beautiful
there. Even the way you say South Africa.
Yeah.
You got a bit of an accent there.
South Africa.
Yeah.
yeah, it's a mad accent.
Like Leonardo, he aced it, bro.
I know. The other day I was at the park with the kids. And my son ran into some other guy's kid, and the guy he apologized.
Yeah.
And I go, is that a South African accent? And he goes, yeah, it is. You know, like it's a mix between Aussie, Maldi, and a bit of British. Like it's such a unique accent. And I go, I can listen to you talk all day.
Yeah.
And we started talking for like, you know, 15, 20 minutes, and you know, a very nice guy. So he lived in South Africa for a little while, and you know, all that stuff. South Africa is a lovely place, actually. We went all around, went to the nice beaches there. I went to Soweto, which is the biggest township in the world. It's like, it's where Nelson Mandela's from, actually. And we went there, and you know, we met some people there, and it's a rough place, bro. We saw some people getting beaten up, and
no way,
mob justice, and people got their heads kicked.
They
govern themselves, so if someone steals or you know committed something like a heinous crime, like he raped someone or killed or whatever, no one's calling the police.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. There's nothing like that.
Even the police probably spectating, eh?
Yeah, no one cares, you know. So they're just savage, you know. Like, and if it's really bad, obviously the whole town will just, you know, beat you up till you die. Mm. Just kick the crap out of you.
You know what I don't like about that? If you're in a sitch where someone's accused you of something you haven't done and everyone's throwing rocks, or like the first bloke starts on you and then his mate sees it and then he runs in, and then a bunch of people just see someone getting chased, and then they just automatically assume that that person's in the wrong, when really, like, you're all sweet.
Yeah, yeah.
And then now you've got a bunch of these people chasing you, launching stuff, and you know what I mean?
That's what mob justice is. So,
yeah, it's a bit iffy.
You see a bunch of people bashing someone.
Yeah.
You know, they're uneducated. They're not like, they didn't grow up like how we grew up.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They grew up really rough.
Yeah.
The first time I was
in those certain parts.
Yeah. The first time I was exposed to mob justice actually was in Bangladesh in 2009. I was in like a marketplace, and I could hear screaming from downstairs, and I looked over like one of the rails, and I just saw the whole marketplace just turn on this Bangladeshi guy.
Yeah.
And they just started kicking the crap out of him.
Haram.
You know, he must
Have been a small bloke, eh?
Yeah, you know, Bangladeshi people, they're very small
in
stature. They're not really big. So I seen this guy getting pumped, man, and that, like, the whole shopping center just turned on him. You know, it was like a marketplace.
Yeah.
And they're smashing him. And he was wearing like a lungi, like a sarong, like a lava lava, you know, like the islanders wear.
Yeah.
He's wearing one of them, and it came off. One guy got a shoe and smacked him on the ass. Like, they're full beating him, you know. And I couldn't handle that. Like, I go, man, bro, the whole place turned on him.
Yeah.
I'm a big bloke. I'm thinking, bro, I'll take about 5-6 of them. Then I'll get my head kicked in after that, but I have to do something, you know what I mean? Like, yeah, it's it was the right thing to do.
You just got to allow it.
Yeah, so I was so pissed off, and I was about to go downstairs. I was looking for a staircase, and then one of the guys that was with me, he's originally Bangladeshi as well, but he lives in America. He's from Detroit.
Yeah.
He grabbed me, and he goes, Ainsbury, he goes, just leave it. He goes, this is just how it is here. Because you can't come here and you might save him and whatever, but tomorrow they're going to bash someone else.
Yeah.
He goes, just leave it. And you know what? Like, yeah, they belted him and stuff like that. And then, like, after like 30 seconds, like, that was it. Like, they just left him. And like, the guy got up and pulled his lungi up and just walked off. You know, he was busted up a little bit. And they got him a few good ones. It was mainly slaps. It wasn't like head stomping where they were going to kill him.
Yeah.
So I found out later he stole a mountain bike.
Mm.
And they caught him. So he was a thief. Like, he stole something, and like, thieves there always get a quick hiding, and then, you know, he'll probably do it again in half an hour, you know, like, that's just how it is. But I was just so taken back. It was the first time it's ever happened. And then I was like, whoa. And then, you know, in South Africa, you know, we saw it, and, you know, we've seen it in a few different places. You know, growing up here as a teenager, you know, you get into fights, get into brawls, people get jumped. Sometimes you're outnumbered, whatever. It's not like that.
Yeah.
Mob justice is, like you said, a whole group of people seeing someone getting pumped, and they're like, oh, let's jump on the bandwagon. He must have done something, and they don't know what he done. He could be innocent, you know? And then, so that's what
I don't like about it, man. It's a bit primitive, if you ask me.
Yeah, that's right.
But yeah, like you said, bro, different cultures, different part of the world. We grew up differently.
Yeah.
But yeah.
But I think everyone should go to South Africa and see it. Actually, I think everyone should go to a third world country and be exposed to how poor people are. Because, you know, to be honest, we're rich kids. We're spoiled brats.
Yeah.
And, you know, we've got everything.
Relative to the rest of the world, 100%. Oh, yeah,
bro. I'm telling you, we're living it up. Like, even just to turn on a tap and get hot water straight away, like, within 10 seconds is a luxury for some people, you know. Like, a lot of people don't have that.
Yeah.
You know, I've been to parts around the world, like, even, like, the rich areas, you can't flush toilet paper down the toilet. Mm-hmm. We abuse that. We, like, you know, it's So I've been to even places in Europe. You know, I just came back from Turkey. You can't flush toilet paper in certain toilets down there. Like, you
clog some places don't even got toilet paper. What do you mean?
Yeah. So
these people.
Yeah. So it's
these people are losing it, bro. Over toilet paper here. In some places, they don't even use toilet paper.
That's right. In all my travels, but I'll tell you now, Australia's the best place to live. Like, I've seen the world, been around and stuff like that. South Africa's nice, but the crime is what wrecks it.
Yeah,
the only place that gives Australia a run for its money is New Zealand. New Zealand is beautiful, but it's expensive. It's hard to find work. In New Zealand, I think you got to have a business for you to live a good life.
Yeah.
But New Zealand, if you got a bit of cash, I'm not even talking about being loaded, just a bit of cash, bro, New Zealand, I'm telling you, is up there. Mm. It's very much like Australia. You know, they're like us, they kick back and stuff like that. But just recently, like I said, I came back from Turkey, fell in love with it. Mm. I don't know if I could live there like full time, but it's
how was it navigating Turkey though? Like not speaking their native language.
We had a couple people with us translating and stuff. But Turkey has mountains. They've got snow. Yeah. They've got desert. They've got rainforests. Mm. They've got beaches, mountains. Like you name it. Like it's like. Everything you can think of, like it's like the whole world's there, you know.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
All these, you know, some countries don't have a desert. They've got a desert. They've got rocky areas. They've got ancient ruins.
Yeah, that's mad.
You know, Noah's Ark actually, like it's in the Bible, it's in the Quran, it would be in the Torah as well.
Yeah.
Actually landed in Turkey, so Noah's Ark is geographically there.
Mm.
There's a lot of prophets buried there, and prophets' companions and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So it's a big history in Turkey. Actually, it's very nice. Mm. Yeah.
You've been around, huh?
Yeah. Alhamdulillah. It's been good.
Yeah.
Well, there's talks of Bulgaria. We want to go to Bulgaria next.
Mm-hmm.
Where's that close to? It's right next to Turkey. Mm. There's actually a big Turkish community there because it's right next to us. So a lot of the people there are actually Turkish.
Yeah.
Like their race is Turkish and they live in Bulgaria. It's a very poor place, a lot of gypsies, a lot of crime and stuff like that. So, that's probably next on the hit list.
Yeah.
I don't know if I can go to America, because of my history.
Mm.
But we'll see. I'd like to go to America as well. I haven't done America yet.
Yeah.
It's on the list. You know, we got family there, as you know.
Yeah. In New York.
Yeah. New York. We've got family in Florida as well.
Mm.
So yeah, America. Yeah,
that'd be mad.
America would be nice. I heard America's rough, but can't be that bad.
Yeah, I wanted to talk to you about New Zealand. So going back 3 years ago, as you know, the shooting that happened in Christchurch. I know that you were one of the first people that flew from Australia to go.
Yep.
So I wanted to talk to you about that. What was your experience in that situation? And what was your reaction when you first heard about it? How long until after you heard the news that you went? And what was your experience like there in New Zealand?
So I went to the mosque here and I prayed Friday prayer.
Yeah.
And when I got back, so you're talking, it's like 2 o'clock in the Arvo.
Yeah.
My phone on WhatsApp is going off. Yeah. Bing, 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 bing. I'm like, what the hell? And everyone's sending me the same video.
Yeah.
Like, I'm what the hell's going on? And I'm like, bro, this has got to be something big.
Yeah.
And it was so annoying. Like every time I press play, I can't even hear what's happening in the video because it's just going bing, bing, bing. Bro, I put my phone on airplane mode.
Mm.
Like I downloaded the video, like let it load up.
Yeah.
And I put my phone in airplane mode and I played the video. So the video goes for like 15 minutes or something.
Yeah.
And I'm watching it. And you know, I've watched some savage stuff. Like, like I'll be honest with you, like when I first watched it, I'm like, you know, like I've seen worse. And then when I, because the first guy to get shot in the video was the Afghani guy.
Yeah.
And when he got shot, I'm like, hey, wait a minute, that guy's Muslim. I go, is that a mosque? And I was like, where'd this happen? I'm thinking straight away, I thought Iraq, Afghanistan, because this stuff happens.
Yeah.
You know, every week there's a bombing in one of these countries, you know, in the Middle East. So I didn't think nothing of it. I know that's sad.
Yeah.
But I was like,
just relative to the West.
Yeah. I was like, you know.
In the Middle East, that's normal.
Yeah.
If there is such a thing.
And then I saw this thing and I kept watching the video, man. And I remember, like, I just saw these people getting shot in the mosque and they're just like big pile of bodies, you know. And I was like, what the heck is this? And my wife's next to me watching it and she's crying, you know. She's like, what's this? Because she's getting messages too about this thing. I watched the whole thing and I go, far out. I took my phone off airplane mode when I finished and then I got a message of like a print screen from the president or something, or one of the committee members, like one big shot from that mosque. He's one of the guys that runs it.
Yeah.
And basically it was like a long message and he goes, guys, you've all seen what's happened.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have the manpower, the expertise, the knowledge or whatever to wash all of these bodies. Yeah. We need help.
Yeah, just the logistics behind it all.
Yeah. So for the people who don't know, when a Muslim dies, they have to get washed. Their body has to physically get washed with water. Mm-hmm. And they get shrouded and then they get buried.
Immediately.
Yeah, as quick as possible. So when these guys got killed in that mosque, in Christchurch, there was two mosques and both of them got hit that day. The first mosque where he killed like, I don't know, like 30-something people, like the big mosque, where he initially went. In that mosque is the washroom where they wash the dead bodies.
Yeah.
So if anyone dies in Christchurch, they're getting washed in that mosque.
Yeah.
But bro, you got 30-something dead people. It's a crime scene. So where are you going to wash bodies now?
They shut it down.
So shut down for, bro, I don't know how long. When I got that message, it killed my life. And you know, I've washed bodies before. I've got that experience.
Yeah.
Alhamdulillah. And I looked at my wife. I go, book me a ticket. This is Friday afternoon. Bro, we're talking, it's like, it's not even 2:30 in the afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
I go, book me a flight. Yeah. I'm going to Christchurch. I need to help these people.
Yeah.
I got mates in New Zealand. Not in Christchurch, but like I got mates in New Zealand.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't ring any, nothing. I just go, book me a one-way ticket. She goes, when are you coming back? I go, I don't know.
Yeah.
Booked a one-way ticket. That night, there was nothing available. But first thing in the morning, there was a flight. New Zealand's like a three-hour flight. It was nothing. So early morning, I got there. There was one of my mates. He beat me actually there. My mate Harris.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, my Indonesian mate. He's came a soldier. From Australia. He was the first person, him and his cousin were the first people from Australia to go. They got there Friday night, the night before, like a few hours before me. They got there. So they picked me up from the airport.
Mm-hmm.
I got there, I go, Harris, bro, what's the situation? He goes, bro, it's bad.
Yeah.
I go, far out. 50 people dead.
Mm.
Another 40 shot, wounded. Bro, he shot a four-year-old girl.
51 to be exact.
Yeah, 51 I'll tell you that. I'll get to that later, Spana. The 51st person died when I went back the second time after a month.
Mm.
Yeah, we had to tell his parents. I'll get to that.
Yeah.
SubhanAllah. Anyway, we get there and we went to, there's like a park across the road from the mosque. And it was just, bro, I can't explain like the vibe.
Heartbreak.
Oh, bro, people were shattered, man. Like it was just, everyone was just broken. I had people from Auckland, people from Wellington.
Yeah.
People from all over came down for support.
The whole world was watching.
Bro, you know, New Zealanders. Bro, they're the most humble people. You've never seen, bro, you've never seen such hospitality from anyone.
Yeah.
These people, bro, we're walking on the street and, you know, we're dressed in the Islamic attire. People are pulling over and just getting out of the car and hugging us.
Yeah.
They're saying, we're with yous. We love you guys. Anything you need.
Yeah.
Bro, I was walking.
All support.
I can't explain it, but I'm walking in the streets of Christchurch. This random guy pulled over. He goes, bro, you hungry? You hungry? Bro, he took me to a kebab shop, bought me food.
Mm.
Don't even know, but never seen him in my life.
Yeah.
Bro, where do you get stuff like that?
Yeah.
So actually the guy, the shooter, wanted to divide everyone, but I can't tell you the unity he created.
Yeah.
This guy and the love from everyone. So we went there and there was a girl that was in charge of, you know, organizing things. She was like a big shot there or whatever. So she said to us, she goes, guys, we need to create teams for washing the bodies.
Yeah.
Like we need to make two teams, one for washing and one for the burial.
Yeah.
She goes, does anyone have any experience?
Yeah.
So I put my hand up. I go, yeah, I'm ready. I go, I came here for this, you know?
Yeah.
So I was with Harris and a couple of other boys and that. There's a couple of boys I recognize as well from New Zealand. I've seen them there. And she goes, yep, no worries. She goes, which team do you want to run? I go, I'll wash the bodies.
Yeah.
No worries. She gave me a vest. I still have this vest.
Yeah.
And it says like Ghusl leader.
Yeah.
So that means the person who's in charge of
washing the bodies.
I go, no worries. She goes to me, talk to a few of these guys, see who has experience, who can work the most efficiently and whatever, and put a team together for me.
Yeah.
All right, sweet. She she didn't know what to do. Like, she didn't know, like, I don't know if she was
who
Muslim
would, man?
Or
who would
like
know what
she,
to
yeah,
do
she
in
kept
that situation.
Crying, like, she was she was very emotional, this girl.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's expected.
Yeah.
So we appointed a whole team for the burial, which was later. There was one brother, Bilal. He's a soldier. He organized the excavators and all that sort of stuff and the digging. He got a team together. That's the later part. The hard part's the washing.
Yeah.
So no worries. I got together and then I go to the boys. I go, boys, whoever wants to assist us with the washing, come with me.
Yeah.
Bro, the whole building followed me to one side of the room and I'm like, all right, guys, I appreciate it.
Yeah.
But I need experienced guys. I understand everyone's got a heavy heart and everyone wants to help and, you know, Matla reward use.
Yeah.
But I need a team that knows what they're doing. I don't have time to train you and teach you and sit down. I understand you would get emotional and stuff, but bro, like, I don't want someone who's going to like keep crying and, you know, and make it worse and, you know.
Yeah. We need to actually get this done.
Yeah, yeah. So I had to break hearts, to be honest, man. Yeah. Hey, bro, how many bodies have you washed? Oh, I've never done it before. Okay, so these people have had their heads blown off and you want your first time that you've washed a body before to be someone with a big hole in his head?
Yeah.
Okay, brother, you need to please sit down and assist with something else. Go visit the families in hospital and this and that.
Give this one a miss.
Yeah, bro. I had a couple of boys that had washed bodies before.
Mm-hmm.
Even them, I had to really sit him down and say, bro, this isn't a normal body.
Yeah.
It's riddled with bullets. Mm-hmm. There's kids there. There's kids that are dead. Yeah. He's ready for it. Yeah, yeah. My team that I had with me, you've never seen a team like that in your life. The boys from Auckland, if they're watching this, bro, you guys are soldiers. I'm telling you, the team that was selected.
All locals?
Yeah, it was mainly locals that was with us. They were just unbelievable. I can't tell you how good we worked together.
Mm.
There was no, I'm in charge. Oh, you're doing this wrong. No one butted heads. No one clashed. No one, nothing. So smooth.
Mm.
Yep, sweet. Then the anxiety kicked in. Why?
We're big responsibility, man.
Yeah, it's a big responsibility. The whole world's watching us. But I very quickly found out that we had to do things very low key.
Yeah.
No cameras, no talking to media, no this, no that. You know what I mean? The media kept trying to ask us questions. I'm like, nah, sorry, no comment, whatever. Anxiety kicked in because we're sitting there, we're ready to rock. First day goes past, bodies aren't getting released. They're sitting in the mosque, just rotting away. It's a crime scene, I understand, but bro, pick the bodies up, like move them to the morgue, something, whatever. Yeah. Day two came. I don't know what happened day two. They must have moved them at
night. So what's their reasoning behind this? They're just collecting evidence?
Yeah, maybe. Look, there's
forensics.
Hundreds of bullets everywhere, bro. There's dead kids. There's dead elderly people.
Yeah.
Some of them are students studying from overseas that got cute. Like, bro, it's a-
Can't identify certain bodies? Is that-
Yeah, I guess they wanted to identify and stuff. And then they had to take them away and do autopsies, which I think is ridiculous. But that's the law in New Zealand. And I'm sure in Australia, if this happened, God forbid, they'll do the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
We've got friends that have been killed and they had bullet holes in them.
Yeah.
You don't need an autopsy report to tell you how this guy died. I don't know why they've done it, but they've done it.
Yeah.
So we had to wait like 2-3 days at least. Maybe I think it was on the fourth day even.
Before the bodies could even move.
Before they even released the bodies to us. So they took them into the morgue, done their autopsies, and bro, you've seen, bro, they chop the bodies up. Yeah, you know when they do autopsies and that. It's disgusting.
Yeah.
Then they told us where the location is. And this wasn't to be leaked to anyone.
Yeah.
So anyone that, talking to the media and, I'm going to tell them, none of that. And the boys were good. We're sitting down, waiting. We're at this place. It was, it's like a funeral place.
Yeah.
And it's a massive room. And there was 4 beds. So I'm going to run 4 beds at a time. We're going to wash 4 bodies at a time.
Yeah.
So we're sitting there. And then the first body came.
Mm-hmm.
The first body that came was a Syrian refugee who escaped war in Syria in search of a better life in New Zealand. Bro, you know New Zealand? It's one of the safest places you can be. Like, especially, bro, you know, Auckland, there's gangs. Wellington, there's... Bro, it's rough wherever you go. Like, there's drama wherever you go. But yeah. Christchurch is a lovely place. It's just like a small town. Everyone
knows. If
there's
any place you want to seek asylum, it's there.
Bro, I'm telling you, like, if this happened in Auckland, like, even that, you'd be shocked. But, bro, Christchurch, like, I can't explain it, bro. It's like Wollongong. Yeah. Like, you know, just like...
New Zealand in general.
Yeah, yeah.
Stuff like this is unheard of, man. Yeah. That bloke was the first person to go down in New Zealand history for terrorism.
Yeah, yeah.
So they don't have stuff like this.
That's right. So the first body to come was that guy.
Mm-hmm.
They brought him in, first person to wash.
Yeah.
So me and two, three boys, we just went in. We had a group of maybe 15, 20 guys.
Mm-hmm.
But the first body that came in, there was only like three, four of us. And they brought him in like a, you know, like a big body bag or whatever. And we had to like slide him off one table, like a stretcher, and then put him on the wash table and then start.
So everybody went through autopsy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's right.
Mm, okay.
So they brought this first one out. And then, we washed him. The next body was his son.
Can you explain to us the process of how a body is washed?
So very briefly.
How long does it take? What exactly is done?
Look,
the ghusl process.
It can take an hour.
Yeah.
It can take an hour. Sometimes maybe longer if there's complications.
Mm-hmm.
But we're on a schedule. Like we have to finish quick. Not in a sloppy way, but we've got a job to do.
Yeah.
So basically when the bodies come out, they've been stitched up, all the bullet holes. Some were really bad, like especially the ones in the face or in the head and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Or certain body parts hanging off, of, for example, like it's a bit full on. So generally we give it a quick once over with water, like lukewarm water. Give them a quick once over, wash off any like sort of excess blood.
Yeah.
We put pressure on like the stomach area to if there's any excrement or any sort of gases or anything in the stomach or anything like that, just to soften it up and just make sure that the body's a bit soft, you know?
Yeah.
Sometimes they come out of the freezer, they're very stiff and stuff like that. You want to be able to move the body.
Yeah.
Give it a quick once over and stuff like that. And then we make wudu for them, which is the ablution what Muslims make before they pray.
Yeah.
So basically, we do that.
Yeah.
We put.
So that's cotton. Basically washing the hands, face.
Yeah, the hands, arms, face. Yeah, all that
head,
sort of stuff.
Feet.
With their mouth, we don't pour water down their throat. Mm-hmm. We just sort of just inside the like where the teeth are and stuff like that, just a little bit inside.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing with the nose. We get like a cotton ball and just in the nostrils and stuff like that. So these are the body parts that need to be washed. That's like the gist of it.
Yeah.
You know, there's other, you know, you wash the right side first, then the left side and all that sort of stuff. And then when we finish, we dry the body and we apply perfumes and stuff like that. There's different nice scents that we apply.
Yeah.
And then we have to shroud the body with the white shroud. There's a part for the top part and the bottom part and make sure that he's completely wrapped.
Yeah.
And when they get buried, they don't get buried in a coffin. Like you see in the movies, they get put in the dirt just with their shroud.
Yeah.
So it doesn't matter if he's a king or he's a beggar in the street, they get buried the same. It doesn't matter.
Everyone's equal.
That's right. So the first person was this Syrian refugee, and then the next person was his son. He had a 16-year-old son who got shot with him.
Allah al-musta'an.
Yeah. So it was very, very difficult. The first body that came out, I looked at the boys, I go, boys, we've got a job to do, you know?
Yeah.
And I had a couple of boys from the team break down, which is normal. That's not
naturally.
You're not tough because you didn't cry.
Yeah.
So alhamdulillah, like Allah gave me the strength not to cry and break down, and like it didn't get to me as much as other people did.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't make me tougher than them.
Of course.
You know, these guys have feelings and emotions, and you know, this happened in their country and stuff, and they got affected.
Yeah.
And, you know, to be honest, some of the guys that were emotional, they're guys that wash bodies or have washed dozens of, like they've done this before.
But this situation is just unprecedented.
Yeah, yeah. There was a couple bodies that rattled all of us, to be honest. And one of them was the body of a young boy. Young boy, he was 3 years old. He passed away.
Long story.
Actually, I met his father. His father got shot. He's a Somalian brother. Lovely, lovely man.
Yeah.
His father got shot as well. And I met his brother. When he was, when the shooter came in, the father grabbed his son and put his head down, kept him on the floor, and they tried to play dead.
Yeah.
His son, for some reason, like got really spooked, and he just got up and he ran towards the shooter. I think he was trying to run through the corridor to escape.
Yeah.
And he just saw the kid and just went, boop, popped him, shot him straight in the face. This kid killed him. And at that time, I had my daughter,
yeah,
who was the same age.
Yeah.
She was also 3 at the time. So I remember when we washed him, we washed him and we shrouded him. He was the easiest one to wash. Like, he's so small. Like, how big is a 3-year-old?
Yeah.
You know, and then we washed him quickly and we shrouded him. And I remember after I shrouded him, I just held him. I was just walking around with him, you know. He was so light, man. He would have been, you know, like 15 kilos, you know, like it's not even that.
Yeah.
And I'm just holding him and I'm walking around. Bro, he didn't even look like he was dead. He looked like he was sleeping.
Yeah.
And his face was glowing, man. Like, I can't explain. He looked beautiful, mashallah. Like, this kid was, you know. And his dad was saying to me, you know, my son, he always comes to the mosque and he loves everyone. He loves praying. He loves reading Quran and he says salam to everyone. And he's a real, real, you know, like jumping around. Everyone loves him, you know. But yeah, subhanAllah. And he's one of the kids that got killed. I met a Indonesian guy that was there. He goes, when the guy started shooting, he had his son. His son was like 6-7 years old.
Yeah.
Or something like that. And he goes, I grabbed my son and I just sort of shielded him with my body. And he copped 4 bullets in the back. So he got shot 4 times. He survived. But he goes, 2 of the bullets went through me and hit my son. His son got shot 2 times and he survived.
SubhanAllah.
Yeah, so I think it was about 40-something people got shot and survived.
Yeah.
They've got life injuries. Like, we met one Bangladeshi sister. She can never walk. She's paralyzed from the waist down.
Wow.
She got married a few months before the shooting.
Wow.
And we've met her husband as well. He's also from Bangladesh. Very, very nice guy.
Yeah.
So it was a bit rough. While we were waiting for the bodies to get released, what occupied our time was going to the hospital. We went to the hospital, which is like 200 meters down the road. And we met all the shooting victims, people that got shot.
Yeah.
And survived.
Yeah.
Yeah, we met, interesting story actually, there was a Turkish guy. Turks are smart, mate. This is why they ruled the world for so long. This Turkish guy was in the mosque and the guy started shooting. He'd done these ones. Played dead.
Yeah.
So he goes, I'm playing dead, laying down.
Mm.
And the shooter, if you watch the video, I don't even know if you can find it anymore. He comes in and out of the mosque a few times, like he's scoping,
yeah.
Like he's shooting into the bathroom. He goes into the ladies section, like he's looking for more people to shoot. He goes, when I was playing dead, he was shooting other people. This guy's playing dead. He goes, when he left the room, he goes, I jumped up and with his hand, he just smashed the window.
Yeah.
When he smashed the window, the shooter heard that and ran back in the room. So he smashed the window and he goes, I dived out of the window. Where he full done a MacGyver. Dives out the window. As he's in midair, he copped a bullet in the thigh.
Wow.
He shot him. He started shooting at him. He said, straight away. He had an AR-15 and he just started pumping lead at him, bro. He copped one in the leg, man. He goes, I saw his hand. His hand was busted up. You know, when you break glass, he smashed it with his hand.
Wow.
So he's bleeding there.
The adrenaline would have been.
Yeah, yeah. And he goes, he got shot in the leg and he just sort of, he was scared that the guy would come to the window and start pumping him like he didn't. He left him and he copped one in the leg, man. And then, he nearly died, man. He's a Turkish guy, soldier, absolute soldier. I remember when we were there, we were in the hospital and then like the whole floor got locked down because the Turkish, I don't know if it was the prime minister or someone, one of the like, someone high in the government of Turkey came down with all of these ministers and they shut the whole floor down, secret service, people with guns, everything came down to come meet this guy. So the Turkish government sent a delegate to, like a whole delegation actually, on a plane to come to Christchurch and meet this guy. And he got like some award, as a hero.
Yeah.
So it was good.
Just to segue from that, one of the thoughts that comes to mind is the gun laws in New Zealand. And after this shooting happened, more stricter gun laws were put in place. And it just makes me think, like, someone that's that ideologically driven, or someone that that's motivated to pull something like that or to attempt something like that, are they really going to look at the law and think to themselves, okay, you know, we've banned semi-automatics or we've banned this particular firearm. Yep. I'm just not going to do this. Or I'm going to, you know, steer clear of this terrorist attack that I'm going to do. Mm. Or for that matter, any sort of crime, any sort of gun crime. Yep. You know, are they going to look at these laws and, you know, hang the boots up and say, oh, okay, that's enough. You know, we got this law here on this rifle.
Yeah.
You know, semi-automatics are banned. Oh, okay, so I'll switch to bolt action. Oh, bolt action is banned. Oh, okay, I'm just going to... It doesn't work like that. That's why I don't understand certain laws.
We're gun owners, okay? Yeah. So we've got our license, we're shooters.
Yeah.
When gun laws change, they affect us, not criminals.
Yeah.
Criminals always have and always will kill each other with illegal firearms.
Yeah.
So when they put restrictions on bolt action, lever action, or whatever on guns, it affects us, people who are doing the right thing.
Yeah.
You know, people are
trying to do it legally.
Yeah. Same thing with driving laws.
Yeah.
There are people who are, like, for example, when I was young, when I got my P's, they had a restriction. I don't even know if it's still like this. After 11 o'clock, you can't have more than one passenger as a P-plater.
Yeah.
That's because some P-platers were doing scummy things. But let's say, for example, I'm not one of those people. Those laws affect me now.
Mm-hmm.
So from the mistakes of some, the majority of people have to suffer. And those majority are people doing the right thing.
Yeah.
Most people live a civil life, work, pay their taxes, paying a mortgage, you know, raising a family. Most people are living a life like that. Not everyone's into a life of thuggery and drugs and women, you know. But these laws affect the people doing the right thing.
Yeah.
You know. So these gun laws, I think, are rubbish. You know, like now in New Zealand, they've banned fully automatic weapons. So you could have an AR-15 before. They've got pretty loose laws.
Fully automatic or semi-automatic?
I'm not sure 100%, but I'm pretty sure, like, in New Zealand...
It might be semi-automatic.
Yeah, but it's much easier to get an automatic or a semi-automatic in New Zealand than it is in Australia. In Australia, it's near impossible. You've got to have, like, a property. You've got to be, like, a pest control shooter. Like, you'll never get one here.
Yeah.
In New Zealand, you can go walk into a shop and you can buy fireworks.
Yeah.
In Australia, you've got to be a pyro technician. Yeah. You've got to have a pyro license, do a course, safety, insurance before you can go near fireworks.
So it's a bit more lax over there.
Yeah.
But yeah, my point is, like you said, criminals are going to get their hands on firearms and they're going to use them regardless of what the law says.
Yeah.
That's the whole point. So what's the point in restricting firearms like that for citizens that are, you know, trying to protect their home or
their property? It's stupid. It's a stupid law. I remember, you know, like I've got a security company.
Yeah.
And I had a contract with, like after Christchurch, a lot of mosques in Sydney and especially Islamic schools, Islamic sites said, you know what, we've got to beef up our security. And some people didn't have security and they go, we've got to get security. And they invested money and the government was giving out grants for they just wanted to protect them. Like the Jewish community. There's no synagogue in Sydney that doesn't have an armed guard there or a Jewish school that doesn't have ex-military, and that's because it's a threat. Like they've been threatened or they fear for something, so they've got that. With Muslims, we never really if you watch the video, the guy's rocking up armed to the teeth.
Yeah,
walks up to a guy.
No one bats an eye.
The Afghan guy looks at him. He goes, "Welcome, brother. Welcome." He calls him in, and he just shotgunned him straight away. Shot him straight away. Like this Afghan guy comes from a country of war. Bro, he's grown up with guns. So when a guy walks in with guns, he's like, hey, bro, come pray. He doesn't care. Even before Christchurch, if someone came with a gun, you wouldn't even I don't know. Yeah. Especially where we're from, you know, someone rocks up to the mosque with a gun, you don't think nothing of it.
Yeah.
So everyone was just taken back by it, you know, no one was ready for that.
Yeah.
So... Yeah, it's a sad, sad situation, you know. But like I said, you know, me and the team, you know, we came together and we got the job done.
Yeah.
You know, we saw some really, really bad bodies. Some of the family members couldn't handle washing the bodies.
Mm.
Like I remember there was a young kid. He would have been about 17 years old.
Yeah.
And his older brother got killed. And his brother was like a superstar soccer player.
Yeah.
I think he played for the national indoor soccer team or something like that. And he couldn't like see his brother in that condition.
Yeah.
So I tried to comfort him as much as I could. I go, look, bro, you don't have to look at his face. You can wash his legs. You can wash his feet. Like a part of his body that's not affected, in hit, yeah. You know. And it took him a while. You know, he's a very, very soft kid, you know.
Yeah.
But you know what? He manned up and he, you know what I mean? He put his big boy shoes on and he came and he started helping us wash the body, bro. And he overcame that, you know. It's not easy, man, when it's your brother.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, you got to understand, Mo, one day either you're going to wash me or I'm going to wash you. It's one or the other.
Yeah.
And whoever's doing the washing, it's going to be hard.
Yeah.
So this, I understood this kid. Like, I'm trying to put myself in his shoes. Like, bro, if that was my brother, bro, would I come in and act like a tough guy, or would I be sitting in the corner crying as well and say, bro, I don't want to
think. No doubt.
So he came and, you know, it was a bit hard for him, but he, you know, he got through it. And then afterwards, when we'd done the burial, he found me. You got to understand, we had like 2 days of nearly no sleep.
Yeah.
We washed nearly 50 bodies because, you know, we can't wash the women. Yeah. So we washed 47 men.
Yeah.
In 2 days, it's a lot of bodies. I don't remember people's faces. So this random kid comes up to me, you know, at the funeral. He goes, hey, bro, do you remember me? Like, I remembered him actually when he came up to me. And I go, yeah, bro. He goes, bro, I just want to thank you so much, bro, like, you know, for encouraging me, you know, like, I'm never going to see my brother ever again. And, you know, like,
at least he was part of the experience.
He goes, washing his body. Yeah, and he hugged me and like really tight, you know, and like he was very happy, you know, about that. So it was good. We had a lot of good experiences with the families. So actually what happened is there was actually 46 men that died.
Yeah.
But the trippy thing is there was a Somalian guy that was with us washing the bodies. He's a volunteer. Yeah. He's assisting us with, you know, running around and doing everything. He had work like the next day or in a couple of days or whatever, and he had to go. He jumps in his car, and he lives like a few hours drive from Christchurch, jumps in his car on his way home, has an accident, dies. Flipped his car, mangled everything, like smashed everything. And I don't know what happened, lost control. I don't know what happened. He died.
Wow.
He left, bro, and like a few hours later, guess who's rocking up in a body bag? I go, what the heck? The same guy, bro. He was just with us. Like, imagine, like, we're sitting there, four bodies getting washed. Bro, no one's got time to scratch their ass.
Yeah.
Running around. I'm like, bro, what the? Get him on the table. Whoop, washed him.
Wow.
That was the 47th one. The women got washed by the women. Actually, they washed the women first. We let the ladies go in first and wash all the ladies.
Mm.
And then the men came because it was mainly men that died. I think four ladies or something like that. They buried him with the victims.
Yeah.
So alhamdulillah, it was good.
I was in the Middle East at this point. I was in Jordan when all this happened.
Oh, were you overseas?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
You've heard about it there?
Yeah, I heard about it there. There was some crazy stuff happening over there at that time as well.
In Jordan?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that was a time when I went to Umrah. So I went to Saudi Arabia.
Mm.
And I remember specifically when I was in the Saudi airport coming back to Amman.
Yeah.
I seen the breaking news. Yemen was firing missiles at Saudi Arabia. And it was nowhere near where I was, but I was near the airport. And usually that's what gets hit first. People like to hit airports first.
Yeah.
So I'm sitting there. Mind you, when I was in Jordan, Syria's kicking off, Iraq's kicking off, Palestine been kicked off, and we're dead center in the middle. You know where Jordan is, right in the middle.
Yeah.
We border with Saudi Arabia, Iraq, Syria, Palestine, with all these countries. So we're dead center in the middle, and all these countries are at war, and I've moved to Saudi Arabia now to go do Umrah, and as I'm coming back, this is I think it was the first time they've been attacked since, I think, like 2 decades or something like that. And I think one Egyptian brother died from some of the debris because they sent anti-missiles and they intercepted all of them. But yeah, that was a crazy time in the Middle East as well.
Yeah.
If I'm correct in the timing, because we've been to Jordan a couple times.
Yeah.
But yeah, just the world in general, man. It's just.
Yeah, it's very sad.
You feel sometimes like it's just up in smoke. Yeah, everywhere you go.
Yeah, it was a sad time, man, to be honest, Christchurch. But like I said to you, it just brought people together, man. Like, you know, the New Zealand community, oh my God, they're such lovely people, man. Like,
yeah,
they came and, you know, they were doing their haka dance as well. There's a few other, war cries that they were doing.
Yeah.
You know, like so many different groups came, bro, from different churches, different organizations, bikey clubs came, bro, mongrel mob, black power, bro, rival gangs that have dramas with each other came and they're doing the haka together, bro. Like, it just brought everyone together.
Yeah.
You know, like, you can't break people like that. Like, they're just so fearless, you know? Yeah. And they were just like.
We're all human at the end of the day.
Yeah. But it was good. I think everything worked out good. And then after 1 month, I went back again. We had like, I don't know, like 40, 50 grand that we collected.
Yeah.
With some of the boys. And we went to go and hand it out to the survivors and to the people who died's families as well.
Yeah.
I know it's not much money and they probably got millions of dollars in donations from so many different charities and stuff like that. I'm sure they got helped. But just from us, we thought, you know, we'd take some money. And we took like 40, 50 grand and we went over there. We met some of the families. And there was a Turkish guy in hospital who got shot.
Yeah.
And he's on life support while we're there. And like we're there visiting him and stuff like that. We're with his parents. His parents are from Turkey. Like they live in Turkey and they flew over to see their son. He lives in New Zealand.
Yeah.
His mum and dad were lovely people. Can't speak a word of English, you know. We're sitting with him. And blah, blah,
his brother was one of the victims.
Yeah, he got shot, yeah. He's probably about 40 years old. I think he's got a couple kids. And we're sitting there in the hospital trying to comfort his mom, you know. He's like, he's in a bad way, hey. Like, he's on life support. He can't, without the machines, he can't breathe. His heart's, you know, he's really bad. Anyways, we stayed really late at the hospital, me and a couple of the brothers. And then we went back to the hotel. We're in the hotel. When I tell you buggered, all day we're doing visits, visiting people. Like, when I tell you depressing, bro, we're meeting people who are never going to walk again, never going to have kids again.
Yeah.
Like people that their life's changed.
Yeah.
So we went back to the hotel. It's like late at night. Put our head on the pillow and my phone starts going off. And my mate rings me. He was with us, but he had a separate room from us. He goes, bro, we got to go. God, what's going on? He goes, the brother just died. That we were just with. Far out. Get dressed, jump in the car, go to the hospital. Guess who's got to tell his parents? We do.
Yeah.
We're sitting and with a very heavy heart, Allah Jazil Khair, my mate, I don't want to say his name, like maybe he doesn't want people to know.
Yeah.
He sat with the family and there's a translator like between us and he said to his mom, he goes, Auntie, your son has gone to Jannah.
Yeah.
And she looked at him like, he goes, he's gone to meet Allah, like that. And she started screaming.
Yeah. Allah Mustafa.
Started screaming, bro. The hairs on my arm are standing up, bro. Like, I can't expose, like a movie.
Yeah.
And she started like losing her. And she was so upset, bro. She started, like,
this is at the hospital.
Yeah. She fell on the floor. You know, his dad, unshaken.
Yeah.
Nothing. He's not frowning. He's not sad. He's not laughing. Just no emotion. His dad's just sitting there like patient, you know.
Processing.
Trying to comfort his wife, you know, just like a rock, his dad. What a man.
Yeah.
You know, the mother's love. And his mum's like really losing it, you know. And I'm looking at the boys. Everyone's upset, bro. And like his wife was there, the guy who passed away, his wife. And you know, it was rough, you know. The translator started crying. And so it was ironic that, because when, you know, I'll tell you something, and this is what was sad about Christchurch. When we went, it was a big media show.
Yeah.
Everyone was there and making videos and whatever and trying to whatever. Oh, yeah. Different organizations and who knows what everyone's intention was, right? It was like a big movie. Yeah. Every media outlet, bro, there was hundreds of different media vans there. The whole world was there. People came from England, from Germany, bro. Germany, there was French reporters. There was Spanish, like every language you can think of, people reporting from there.
Yeah.
You know? It was like a big, big movie, you know? Like, and that's what was sad about it. Like, they made it like this big thing. When all the smoke cleared, no one cared about the families. No one cared about the victims. No, like nothing. Yeah. It was just like a big movie.
Yeah.
And then everyone went home. When we went back after a month,
the foremost people who need support.
Yeah, yeah. When we went back after a month, when the dust settled, brother, it was like it happened yesterday.
Yeah.
Even though it was a month before, because I went maybe a month and a bit after.
Yeah.
It was like it just happened. It was like it happened that day. Yeah. The vibe was so dark. It was such a, you know, Christchurch, a few years ago, there was a big earthquake and some people died and it destroyed the whole city. There was a massive earthquake. You'd have been young then.
Yeah.
And that was the last time where people saw unity there, like where everyone came together and, you know, whatever. It was good.
Yeah.
So sometimes something bad has to happen for people to unite. But, bro, when we went back the second time after a month, man, it was like, man, who's helping these people, man?
Yeah.
Like there was one girl. She's Palestinian. Her husband died. He got killed. So the government gave her some money. But because she's an import, she doesn't know how to deal with it. His brother came and took that money. So her husband died.
Yeah.
She got some payout. His brother came and took that money and tricked her and ripped her off. And I don't know what happened. I don't know how much money he took or stole or whatever, but this is the stuff that was happening. So when we went back after a month, we uncovered all of this, you know, stuff that's happening, and we were like, it was bad anyway. Yeah. But yeah, so when we went back after a month, it was good, you know, like we went to go see everyone. And
for someone to process all of this, it takes a certain character, right? Not everyone's built like that to go through, you know, the things you've seen.
Yeah.
Do you think some of that comes from when you worked at the hospital?
Yeah. I've seen a lot of things, bad things happen in front of me.
Yeah.
I've seen a lot of videos and stuff. You know, growing up, you know, as a kid, you know, back in the day, you know, when you first get internet at home, you're on all these websites.
Yeah. Rotten.com.
Yeah, Rotten.com and Ogrish and all these. Yeah.
Faces of Death.
Yeah, yeah. You see all these videos. Like, you're desensitized to a lot of it and stuff. And then when you see it happen in front of you, like you just become desensitized. You know, watched a bunch of bodies and seen a lot of dead bodies and stuff like that. Yeah, you become desensitized. And also, you know, working in the hospital, you know, seeing five bodies a day.
How long did you work in the hospital for?
A year and a bit.
Yeah.
Yeah, worked in a few different hospitals around Sydney. So you're seeing a lot of things, you know, like I've seen burns victims. I've seen people with axes in their heads, gunshot victims. People get run over. A guy jumped out of a plane and his parachute didn't work. Like I've just seen a lot of bad things, like bodies that are really, you know, sort of messed up.
Yeah.
So in Christchurch, you know, it was full on.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think that prepared me. It was like I was, you know, ready for it.
Yeah.
You know, so I guess it did help me a little bit.
What kept you in the hospital, man, for that whole year and a half? You could imagine, bro, how much people would have come in and out of that gig and just left, man.
Bro, I'm telling you.
Every single day you're calling me. Every single day you're coming home with a new story, something that you've seen, witnessed.
I can write a book on the stories at the hospital. Bro, when we were in the hospital, bro, the stuff that used to happen was just unbelievable. I think for me, you know, when I was 19, I changed my life and I pulled up and I just left all that sort of
180.
Yeah. When I left that criminal life, I got bored, to be honest with you. Like I was just bored with my life. Like I wasn't. Yeah. I missed the drama.
Yeah.
You know, and the rush.
Yeah.
And I feel like when I started doing security, I got that rush back.
Yeah.
Because we you know, it's on. You know, like some guy comes in and wants to punch on. Ah, oh, boys, let's get him. You know, like it was just. And getting paid to do it. You know, like,
and you were still young at that stage as well.
Yeah, I was 21, 22. And yeah, it was good, you know. Like I guess I just missed that.
Yeah. Did you work in the psych ward?
Yeah, I was in mental health, yeah. So we were working with people that they're just standing there. He looks normal, talking normal, and then he'll just hook you. Like one of our guards, I don't want to say his name, He's just sitting there. One of the guys. This guy's married, kids, got a bunch of kids. Yeah. Nice guy, very friendly.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
We had one patient, just turns around, boom, square in the nose, broke his nose. One of our guards, one of our
Come
mates.
On.
Imagine that, bro, like working for $20-something an hour.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Risking everything.
They don't get paid enough, man.
And boom, broke his nose, dropped him. The boys jumped on him and like he kicked the shit out. Like, you know, the boys belted him. Actually, one of the boys got charged. There's a guy that was working with us, he's Tongan. He grabbed this guy, went, boom, and broke his jaw. And actually, he lost his security license. He got charged. He didn't go to jail, but he got in big
What did they hit him for?
Because he hit that guy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he hit one of the boys.
What are you meant to do in that situation? How do you handle something
there
like that?
He used excessive force. He's got big hands, you know. You know, some islanders have got big hands. This guy was tough, you know.
Yeah.
And he went, boom, rattled him, bro, and dropped him.
You know? You got to sedate them?
Yeah, so sometimes you have to pin them down.
Yeah,
and they just give them a needle.
What's in the needle? What are they giving?
There's Diaz, there's Medaz, there's different medications that like 5 mil, 10 mil, whatever. But we've had people on ice. You know, like I'm a big guy. I'm 120 something kilos. Yeah,
yeah.
We've had guys that are like 60 kilos, 70 kilos, and you got like four or five fully grown men trying to hold this guy who's on ice down. And I'm thinking, where's this guy getting his strength from? So these guys that are on ice, very hard to restrain.
Yeah.
And I'm looking at us, I'm like, bro, are we actually really tough or is he tough? Like I'm thinking, what is it?
Yeah, yeah.
But then very quickly we learned that it's the ice.
Yeah.
But imagine getting a guy that's 120 kilos, someone our size,
yeah,
on ice. Who's going to hold him down? Mm-hmm. You know? So.
Any female workers? Female security guards?
Yeah, we had a couple that worked in-house. It was good.
Yeah.
When we had a female patient, it's always a gray area. Why are you touching me? Did you just, did you touch me here? Like, you know how it is sometimes with women, you know? So I remember this prostitute came in, because it was in Liverpool, and she had track marks everywhere. So they couldn't find a vein to put a cannula in so they can give her a drip or even to sedate her. Like, they can't find a vein to jab her anywhere.
Yeah.
And then, like, her feet as well had track marks. So she's shooting up in her foot.
Wow.
You know, her feet are just like bleeding and like, bro, she was disgusting. Like the people that were coming in were absolutely putrid, man. Like bottom of the barrel. And, you know, I used to wear this to work and I had to be like, I look Muslim, you know. So she came in, she tried to fight everyone. Anyway, we dropped her straight away. She was only this big. We dropped her on the ice, whatever, and we're pinning her down. And it's part of procedure. You know, we've got to put gloves on. Who's going to touch her?
Yeah.
So as I'm putting gloves on, she looks at me and she goes, oh, you effing Muslim, you know, this and that. And blah, blah, blah. Starts going off, you know.
Yeah.
We don't care about stuff like that. And she goes, oh, why are you putting gloves on? What, you think I've got AIDS? I go, nah, sis, I've got AIDS. You know, like that, you know, just killed her life, you know. Like,
yeah.
So you get heads like that. But security taught me how to de-escalate a lot of things.
Yeah.
I think if I knew what I know.
You had that quality before security.
Yeah.
But I feel like it enhanced it, but you had that quality before security.
You know, I remember even in school, like my mates will, like there'll be a big fight or whatever. And I'd always like sort it out.
Always in the mix. Yeah,
I'm always like, no one's fighting no one. You know, like I'd always try and stop it. Like I've had that peacemaker mentality for a long time, you know, like since I was young. Yeah, you're right.
Because you can see where it goes. You know where it goes. That's why.
Yeah, like there's a lot of situations that happen in the hospital. They could have turned sour.
Yeah.
But we were able to de-escalate. If you know how to speak to people, man, it's not, you know, like going in there, guns blazing, you know. Like you're not a copper.
Yeah. You know, so. Did you have David Ord as your teacher? When he did he's a legend, bro.
Yeah.
I like that guy. He's very fair.
Yeah, he is.
He's blunt, but he's fair. If you read between the lines, he's.
Do you know when we started the course? But we've been there for 2 minutes. Everyone like signed in.
Yeah.
And it's the start of the lesson. He picks out some random guy that was sitting like near me.
Yeah.
He goes, "You Indian guy, are you Indian?" He goes, "Yeah, I am." He goes, "Get out! I don't like Indians."
Seriously.
He kicked him out of the course. The guy's like, we're all looking around. Bro, there was like 10 Indians in there, but he just kicked this one guy out. So the guy grabs his folder and like, bro, he's going to cry.
Mm.
And he just goes, "Oh, sorry, sir." And then, like, he got up to walk, and then he, as he's about to walk out of the door, he closes the door. He goes, "You dickhead." He goes, "Go sit down." He goes, "You idiot." He goes, "You're not ready for security." He goes, "You nearly started crying. I just told you to get." I goes, "Go sit down, you idiot." Like that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He prepares you. Listen, he prepares you for the real world. Yeah, that's what he does. Like, he's harsh. Bro, I've seen so much people cry in the course, straight out. Yeah. But he prepares you for real life situations, man.
Yeah, yeah.
And he puts you in some situations where you got to really question your moral code.
Yeah. So but there's a lot of people that do dodgy security licenses.
Yeah.
Those people aren't trained. If someone trained that sector,
yeah,
bro, you know he's got it down pat. And you know, the course went for like 2 weeks. This Indian guy learned a lot. You know, I spoke to him after, you know, like he was so taken back. He wasn't like, none of us were ready for that.
Yeah.
You know, but it really does teach you a lot of stuff, man. And, and you know, working in security, you deal with a lot of people. Like, we have to break the news to families that their loved ones are dead. Or, for example, someone's mum died.
Yeah.
And there's only two visitors at a time.
Mm-hmm.
But then, you know, for example, Lebos.
Yeah.
Bro, they come in, 50 of them at a time inside the room. Their mum died, their dad died.
Yeah.
Bro, try telling a grieving family like that, "Oh, you just can't come in like that."
Yeah.
It would be on straight away.
Yeah.
So you've got to know how to speak to them. Or imagine like an Islander family, for example. Me coming in, saying, it's not going to happen. This guy's dad just died. There's not 50. I'm going to bring 100 people in here and you're not going to do nothing about it. Bring all the cops you want. My dad died.
Yeah.
Like, so you've got to know how to speak to people. If you don't, you have problems all the time.
He puts you in stitches. I think one of the stitches he asked us was, what if you seen... So you're doing security, this is the situation.
Yeah.
At like, let's say like a Woolies. You're doing receipt checkouts. And you see an old man, old white man, in his 50s, 60s, and he's raising his voice to a six-year-old Chinese girl. I'm pretty sure this was the example. This was years back when I was 18, when I was doing the course.
Yeah.
But it was something like that. And he's gone around the classroom asking everyone, what would you do in this situation? Some people are saying, oh, we'll take him down. Some people are saying, we'll stay close by and we'll see what happens next. Yeah. Everyone's given all mixed different answers. But the majority was, we'll take him down, we'll do a citizen's arrest, blah, blah, blah. And then, you know, he's got the slide, he's got the button, he puts the button, he presses the button, and it's a photo of him with, I think he's adopted a Chinese girl or someone of Asian background.
Yeah, that's right.
And he said, what if that was me? You know, I've adopted her, I've raised her since she was a baby. Like, why would you assume that? And you don't know the backstory, you don't know what's going on with these people, and you've taken me down. You know, now you're the one getting arrested and you're the one getting charged. So he puts you in situations like that, and he really makes you think. He really jogs your mind, because that's where you have to be. You have to think on the spot as a security guard. And that's no joke, man, because like you said, your mate was defending his fellow security guard, and you know, now he's getting charged, loses his license. So it's not a joke.
When I got the security contract at a couple of the mosques in Sydney, one particular mosque, I don't want to say which one, but one mosque, I had a meeting with the board members, and they go to me, they go, "Ayman, we want an armed guard."
Yeah.
I listen. I go, "You don't want an armed guard." They go, "Oh yeah, but if someone comes here, we want someone to shoot him." I go, "Brother, this ain't Bollywood."
Yeah.
Okay. I go, "If you've got an idiot here coming with a gun shooting, and my guard's got a gun, now you've got two idiots with guns shooting in a public thoroughfare where there's people walking around, kids, elderly people, you got two idiots. This ain't the wild, wild west, you know what I mean?" And then I go to them, "You're better off getting a police dog." They go, "Oh, no, no, you can't have a police dog because the dogs are, you know, they're unclean and what if it bites someone?" Drama, drama.
Yeah.
We ended up just going for just like a normal guard.
Yeah.
And I debriefed my guards, you know, and I sat with them. I go, "Boys, listen. Okay, if anyone comes here with a gun shooting, brother, I don't want you to do nothing except make that call.
Yeah.
Brother, jump behind the car. Don't let no one see you. Call the police."
Yeah.
There's nothing you can do about it. Bro, a guy's got a fully automatic weapon and you've got a freaking security lanyard on. That's all you've got. Bro, you don't even
You got a high vis on. That's all.
Nothing, bro. Like, even if you want to take off your steel cap boots and throw them, bro, how long does it take to take off your... The guy's put 10 in you already.
Yeah, yeah.
So I go, "Bro, I don't want no hero stuff." I go, "Just make that call."
Yeah.
And, you know, we had good, you know, the police in Sydney. I know people aren't very fond of the police. And, you know, to be honest, for the most part, neither am I.
Yeah.
But during this Christchurch thing, the police were very, very good with us. They used to come to the mosque and do patrols twice a day.
Yeah.
They liaised with us. They got our personal numbers. We had their numbers. And, like, mm-hmm. any drama,
yeah.
the police were there. Yeah. Like, I remember one guy came to our mosque. And he had like a big steel cross in his hand, and the bottom part of it was like a sharpened edge. It was like a dagger.
Yeah.
And he's just walking up and down the mosque, this and that. Anyways, the police got called. They came, stripped him naked in the street. But the guy was in his, just in his undies, you know, stripped him naked. They gave him a 24-hour walk-on notice. You come back here, you're going to get arrested.
So you're saying back here in Sydney, around Sydney mosques, there was a bigger police presence.
After Christchurch. There was a big thing. So this is like probably 2 weeks after Christchurch happened, this guy's doing this.
Yeah.
Imagine how sensitive everyone is. Everyone's upset. Like, I remember when I was in the mosque, bro, people were praying like this.
Yeah.
Like, everyone was scared. Like, it was very sad, like, that people were afraid like that.
Yeah.
And a lot of people didn't come to the mosque.
But that's the reality, man.
Yeah, yeah, that's right. Bro, no one wants to go through that.
Yeah.
So everyone was like on edge. And this guy comes and just, you know, when I looked at him, because I got the call straight away and I went down, and he looked Arab, and I was like he's got the ethnic look. Like, I'm like, bro, is this guy Muslim? Is he like, what's going on? Then I saw the cross in his hand. I'm like, oh, okay. Well, we found out later, I think he was Assyrian or something like that, or Chaldean. And anyways, the cops came and they stripped him, gave him a walk-on notice. Probably 2 hours later, he comes back. They stripped him again. And
what's his deal? What does he want? Did they find out? Like, is he a local?
Actually, to be honest, the second time he came, he was making threats. He goes, I'm going to come in there and I'm going to start killing people. So the police took that seriously, and they actually handcuffed him and stuff. They arrested him. They questioned him for a long time in the street.
Yeah.
And then they gave him a
20. What, was he drunk or?
Nah, bro, to be honest, he was all right. He just looked angry.
Okay.
And then the second time they gave him a 28-day walk-on notice. Like, he can't come to the it's like an AVO sort of thing.
Yeah.
Can't come back. Guess what he does after an hour? But you know what's sad? If a Muslim guy had done that at a synagogue or a church,
Gonski.
Brother, there'll be no walk-on notice. It would be a terrorism charge.
Yeah.
And he'll never see the light of day. Like, that's what's unfair. This is why I'm not fond of these laws. That it's rubbish.
Yeah.
So anyways, the third time he came back, cops grabbed him and went to jail.
Yeah.
Like, that he, you know, he got locked up. One of my Afghan friends saw him.
Yeah.
At the mosque. And he walked up to him and he goes, hey, bro, how you going? This and that. The guy's like full angry. But my mate will kick the shit out of him, you know. And he looked at it. And you know, Afghans, bro, they're strong people. They come from war. All they know is war and violence and death. And so when you come pull out a gun or a knife, an Afghan's going to laugh at you, bro. They're very strong people.
Yeah.
And my mate's Afghan walks up to him and he goes, brother, this is a mosque. He goes, brother, if you want money, everything that's in my pocket, I'll give it to you. Brother, you want food? You come in here, we'll make you the best food, bro.
Biryani.
Yeah. Biryani, palau, whatever you want, brother. You want money, you want food, you want a place, no problem, brother, we're here. And he goes, but bro, if you want to punch on, he goes, I'll kick the shit out of you. Like, that's basically what he said to him.
Yeah.
But when he said that, the guy fired up and he wanted to be Rambo. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, my mate would have knocked him out. But anyways, the police came and handled it. And you know when the police came, one of the senior sergeants came, because they wouldn't send like flop coppers. Like, it was... Right, every copper that came had stars and stripes. Like, it was always like senior ranking police officers from Mountjoy Police.
Yeah.
And then I remember when they came, I go, officer, please don't think that anyone here is scared of this guy. I go, we called you because we fear for his life.
Yeah.
I go, I don't want someone from here to jump on his head, because then you'll have a meet. You know, the media actually was at our mosque.
Yeah.
And they were filming, and they were just, not that incident, but they were there like sniffing things out. And I go to the cop, and he started laughing. And I go, bro, we're not scared of this guy. I go, I'm worried for him. I go, someone here will be a loose cannon and just start jumping on his head, bro. And then you got someone in a coma.
Yeah.
He goes, yeah, I appreciate it. So the cops were good, you know. And then COVID happened. They started arresting people for masks. Yeah, people got
that's
bashed.
A whole rabbit hole in and of itself.
Yeah, that's another episode.
Yeah. All right. We've done over an hour.
Yeah, yeah.
I appreciate you coming down.
Anytime.
It was good chatting. Hopefully we will save some of that stuff for the next episode.
Yeah, yeah. Inshallah.
Alrighty. Take care. We're off.